I would like to greet warm regards to Dr. Liz Dinalia Stuti as the Chief Director of Cipto Mangkusumo Hospital. Good morning, Dr. Liz Dina. I would like to greet also Prof. Kia Yuchu, the CEO of International Medical Services Center from NGMH. Good morning, Prof. Kia Yuchu. I would like to also greet Prof. Ye Chun Chen, the Director of Center for Infection Control, NTUH. Good morning, Prof. Ye Chun Chen. And then a warmest regards for Dr. Pri Martani as the Human Resource, Education and Research Director of Cipto Mangkusumo Hospital, and also to Dr. Sumariono as the Medical and the Nursing Director of RSPM. And all two participants, welcome to the NTUH RSCM Joint Webinar Episode 1. The title this morning will be the Hospital Strategy in Response to COVID-19. And then before we proceed to the next session, I would like to give an opportunity to Dr. Liz Dinalia Stuti to give the opening remarks. Please, Dr. Liz Dinalia Stuti, the session is yours. Hello, Dr. Liz Dina.
Let me first extend my sincere thanks to Professor Yi Chun Chen, Director of Center for Infection Control, National Taiwan University Hospital, Dr. Sumariono, Director of Medical Service and Support, Cipto Mangkusumo National Hospital Indonesia, and Dr. Tri Martani, PhD, Director of Human Resource Education and Research, Cipto Mangkusumo National Hospital, who will moderate our remarkable webinar this morning. Dear colleagues and friends, the COVID-19 pandemic has hit us hard. Today, more than 19 million cases have been reported, with 700,000 deaths across the world. It has taken our respectful colleagues, beloved families, and friends. It exploited our vulnerable health system and economy. As the people who work closely with COVID-19 patients, we have seen sadness, misery, depression, and rejection. However, it has also cherished us with resiliency, unity, adaptability, and solidarity. We have learned that Taiwan's handling of COVID-19 has been exemplary. Many countries have praised this country's exceptional contact tracing, testing and treating efforts. With a population of 23.8 million, Taiwan has performed over 82,000 tests with 477 confirmed cases and only 7 deaths. In Indonesia, we have recorded more than 118,000 confirmed cases with 5,500 deaths. Our hospital solely has performed more than 10,000 tests, and we have treated over 2,000 suspected and confirmed COVID-19 patients, and many are at productive ages between 20 to 49 years old. Most of our patients who died have multiple comorbidities, including cancer, hypertension, and diabetes. We are curious about these death rate differences. Is it due to containment and mitigation strategies, the extent of testing, demographic characteristics, or unique healthcare system, including critical care capacity and robust hospital preparedness? In the light of this pandemic, it is truly an honor to partner and host a joint webinar with National Taiwan University Hospital. Our collaboration in fellowships, symposiums, and visitations have improved hospital quality care. Through this webinar, I hope we can learn from each other, particularly in handling patients with comorbidities and asymptomatic patients who may breach the screening gate unrecognizably. I wish us all an insightful discussion. Let's seize this moment and push our limits in strengthening the healthcare system. Thank you all once again. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Dr. Liz Dinalia Stuti, for the opening remarks. And now we will proceed to the next session. It's the opening remarks from Prof. Chia Yuchu. Prof. Chia Yuchu is the CEO of the International Medical Service Center from the NTUH. Please, Professor Chia Yuchu, the time is yours.
Hello, good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Dear friends from Indonesia, it's a great pleasure to organize this webinar during this pandemic of COVID-19. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Lisbina Lestuti for her continuous support on our collaboration project between the two hospitals. There will be a series of 7 different conferences in the following weeks. We hope that we can, through this webinar, we can learn each other and most importantly, to save people's lives. Today we will have 2 lectures from 2 speakers in NTUH and your hospital. And I think these are 2 important lectures. And I wish all of you enjoy the webinar, and I hope you and your family are all healthy and a happy weekend. Dear Dr. Chumatani, now the session is yours. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Chia Yuchu, for the opening remarks. And now we will enter the core session, the scientific session that will be moderated by Dr. Trimartani. Dr. Trimartani is an ENT head and neck physician and currently serves as Human Resource, Education and Research Director of Cipto Mangunkusumo Hospital. To Dr. Trimartani, please, the session is all yours.
Thank you, Dr. Rabi. I would like, first of all, to thank Professor Chia Yuchu and Dr. Lisdina for giving our first opening remark in opening our joint webinar. For the first speaker is Professor Yi Chuan Chen. She's a director, Center of Infection Control, National Taiwan University Hospital, Professor of Department of Medicine, National Taiwan University College of Medicine. And she will deliver hospital preparedness and response for COVID-19 in her experience in Taiwan. Without delay, I would like to ask Professor Yi to proceed.
I'm Yiqing Chen. Thank you for introduce and moderate this section. It is my honor and a privilege to share NTUH and the Taiwan experience. First slide. Is it okay for the slide? Is it okay? Today I will share experience from our hospital, but I also will explain the policy from the government, as I am one of the advice board of the Taiwan CDC. And during my presentation, I will explain the reason why the integrated intervention from different sectors is very important. We cannot alone. Because Taiwan is a very crowded country and the proximity to and frequent travel to and from China. In this January, we're facing the influenza season and we have presidential election as well as Chinese New Year. Many people will come back to Taiwan, and we are really a lot of pressure at that time. When we have information from China, so at that time, government and the advice board and our country, we decide we must act and act now. This is very important. For contagious disease, for emerging infectious disease, we must act. So, Taiwan effective delay and contain community transmission by the following intervention. We, based on the experience in SARS, we prepare and strengthen every year. Therefore, when we had information from Wuhan, China, we proactively respond. So we early initiation are very important. There are several strategies in Taiwan, including continuous epidemic surveillance and risk assessment. We initiate tightened border control and quarantine. We strengthen the healthcare system. We allocate and manage medical supply and equipment, in establish and enhance testing capacity. We continue risk communication and management. We continue community-based epidemic prevention, epidemic investigation, including case contact tracing. And we continue international collaboration and information exchange. Government, through the media, social media, a lot of channel to provide the information every day. This is one of the information they announced yesterday. We can see how many patient tests, how many confirmed by, and newly every day. From this graph, you can see how many patients by onset day. You can see the latest part is those imported cases. So in Taiwan, not only the number of confirmed cases are low, also the majority of them are imported. However, people criticize whether we are under testing. You can see the data. This is the confirmed cases is blue one. As I mentioned, many imported cases. However, we also have extended COVID-19 screening program demonstrated in green one. We continued nationwide through different reference lab located in different parts of Taiwan, in medical center, regional hospital, and CDC. We continue provide the testing, the budget covered by government. We also provide many guidance, information, recommendation for people in Taiwan, including hospital, including the community. Also, they do effort to translate to different language. Most important, from national policy, we hospital need to translate, implement in daily practice. And important, the government through regional cross-sector coordination and the multi-district task force. We need to translate and demonstrate and give guidance to healthcare worker in our hospital in a feasible and a sustainable way. Most important, the government and the hospital with commitment to contain COVID-19. We not just mitigate from the beginning, we can decide to contain, try our best to contain the COVID-19 in Taiwan. To have time to surge capacity, no matter PPE, no matter healthcare capacity and others. Through these two slides, we'll demonstrate the different level from the national policy to hospital policy. We can see the COVID-19 in a borderless world, they're moving, they can move without passport, without admission consent, they can translate. So government initiate travel alert, restriction and travel ban, especially to healthcare worker. And for people from other country, we control the border and the entry restriction. In addition, when they into Taiwan, we conduct risk assessment, no matter Taiwan people or foreigner, and they stratified by home isolation, quarantine, or health management. In addition, the government announced strengthen, inform the community for hand hygiene and the universal masking or social distance. In addition, we continue very extensive, comprehensive community surveillance and epidemic investigation. In addition, through healthcare network, patient divergence and transfer to avoid every patient direct access to medical center, for example, NDUH. This scenario happened in SARS. At that time, we identified taking care a large proportion of SARS patients in our hospital. And it turned out to be we had outbreak in our hospital. So government very clearly demonstrated their policy that they should distribute in different location, in different part of the Taiwan, and in different hospital. Everybody should involved in COVID-19 healthcare. For people coming back from foreign overseas travel, or you have some epidemic risk, they are stratified into home isolation, quarantine, and self-health management. They are the definition are very clear, and the responsible authority are clearly demonstrated. Among several strategies, I would like to emphasize the face mask for people without any discomfort. We initiated this recommendation early during the pandemic. You can see as of April 3rd, Taiwan, the incidence of COVID-19 and the proportion of local cases compared to Singapore. As you know, Taiwan and Singapore both have experience during SARS and both initiate improved very stringent measure. But the only, at least one of very important difference are Taiwan recommend the use of mask in the early in the pandemic. In contrast, Singapore did not recommend the use of mask until April 3rd and initiate its stay home policy on April 7. Why we emphasize this? This is a very feasible and a very low cost strategy. Just because they are based on SARS experience. Before that, only person with open tuberculosis wear mask in public. So during the pandemic, during the SARS epidemic, wearing a mask in public was stigmatized. Therefore, we educate the public to wear a mask as a practice of respect hygiene after SARS. Either this is for source control or reduce the exposure. The wearing a mask by healthy people may prevent potential asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic transmission. Regarding the infection prevention control in healthcare setting. For example, in our hospital, we double triage at emergency department, as well as hospital entry control. What does it mean double triage? As you know, in daily practice, when patients visit emergency department, they are stratified by severity illness in order to decide whether you are taking care of the priority. However, we triage patients outside the emergency department. If high risk, they are allocated to special space, like this, the negative pressure isolation room, located at emergency department. For there's no risk, they can go through the as daily practice. In addition, we also entry control initiate very early, including wear mask, temperature check, visitor restriction, and we check the epidemic risk so-called TOCC, travel occupation contact tracing. In the hospital, all our effort, infection prevention and control, are to prevent intra-hospital spread and protect our health occupation safety in order to balance between pandemic control as well as business continuity. This is very important for National Taiwan University because we are a referral center. We need to provide the healthcare even during pandemic. This slide is very familiar with many people because no matter from WHO, US CDC or Taiwan CDC, we emphasize several strategy, including screening to early identify, recognition and source control. We isolate patient and quarantine those exposure through admission control. For example, I explained in previous slide, engineer and environment control. This is very familiar and work every day, but we emphasize that empirical precaution. We initiate airborne, droplet and contact precaution for suspect cases of COVID-19 before confirmation. In addition, we strengthen, emphasize the compliance of standard precaution for all patients. This is very, very important, especially in country or area when COVID-19 or sustained transmission in the community. In addition, when you have risk assessment, it indicates we need to integrate transmission-based precaution in as well. Control at the source is very important, but not limited to individual hospital. Need to work together the whole country and the whole world, because early case finding, aggressive contact tracing. This is a reason why we can maintain very low number of cases in Taiwan. Every cases we ask, according to the government, we need early identify patient and report to the government within 24 hours. Then we'll initiate the contact tracing. So for every confirmed cases, the hospital and the government will tracking about 100 to 200 contact, and they will receive some testing using the RNA PCR. So government asks many hospital to establish the PCR testing capacity in January. In addition, for every, we isolate in the negative pressure room if available, or single room isolation and the quarantine for those exposure. In addition, we are very emphasize the healthcare personnel, health surveillance and reporting. During the peak of the disease in Taiwan, the hospital base, we threw a web-based hospital-wide surveillance and reporting system. Every personnel need to report every day in order to early identify healthcare worker with risk or with infection of COVID-19. This is announced and modified timely by government regarding how to early identify patient and report to the government and to conduct the testing. They including clinical and epidemiologic criteria. I will explain this. Since very early, this is one version of the case definition. For high risk overseas travel, initially is have overseas travel or come back from Wuhan, China. If the individual have very mild symptom, for example, fever or acute respiratory tract symptom and others, then fulfill the criteria and then need to testing and report. But regarding the low risk of exposure, they need to be pneumonia, then fulfill the criteria. This is a so-called risk base and to balance the resource we have. In addition, concern on the community spread. So government initiate expanding COVID-19 screening program, including every individual with severe influenza once they have negative result of rapid test or PCR, they will conduct at the same time of COVID-19. We also control along the path, including what I mentioned is at the emergency service, and we provide some telehealth. Regarding the hospital entry control, we check the temperature, and before the pandemic, people can come in to the hospital to visit their family when they are being hospitalized. But since during these recent months, the government announced to restrict the time and number of the visitor for every inpatient. But when you visit the hospital, we check the risk through, initially we're using the questionnaire, but government initiated this information system in late January. They integrate immigration information through National Health Insurance Information System. So individual visit hospital, we need to check their insurance card to get this information to make sure they are safe. If they are high risk, they are not allowed to enter our hospital. In addition, from the individual label, we ask in universal masking. In addition, hand hygiene. This is emphasized for many years. In addition, we have national policy regarding the selection use of the PPE. In addition, government asks every hospital need to provide additional training for healthcare individual. We through the web-based education system or face-to-face training, especially for the technique. In addition, we have some minor policy regarding 30-minute policy for people healthcare working in negative pressure room or clean room and others. And then this is the final slide. As I mentioned, National Taiwan University need to continue provide healthcare, but balance the risk of introducing the COVID-19 into hospital. So we need to very delicate to balance the risk. So we need this flow chart. For example, if this is not indicate, not emergent, procedure or hospitalization, and then have risk of COVID-19, then we are delayed and provide alternative schedule. If it's indicated and it should be conducted during the isolation or quarantine period, then have also have COVID-19 risk. We are stratified, have symptoms or not. And then we decide to isolation level and we conduct the SARS-CoV-2 RNA PCR testing. But at the same time, we will empirical initiation of precaution and isolation and conduct the procedure at the same time. And we will modify or downgrade the isolation according to the PCR result. This is what our conduct in the past 7 months. Thank you for your attention. Oh, in addition, I take this as a conclusion. This is very, very unexpected. Emerging infectious disease involves so many individuals. Although people think this is the low mortality, but you take a look, the number of individuals lost their life, I just cannot imagine. People in Asia, government in Asia, had experience during the SARS, so initiate and implement very stringent strategy. However, for different perspective, the result had different. So this is a reason why we need to work together and share experience to combat the emergent infectious disease together. Thank you for your attention.
It's a very interesting and thank you for sharing. I would like to highlight that the main thing is to always to act quickly and then prepare for the early initiation, especially when we have experienced the epidemic SARS recently, and then should have a national policy, and then also releasing the stigma to change from using masks is patient with stigma with tuberculosis change into a respect to health. And then intra-hospital, we have to double the triage and also aggressive contact tracing. And of course, control all the probable path of transmission. Well, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of question on those topics, Professor Yi. Thank you very much. And then we will proceed with our second speaker, Dr. Sumariono. He's the director of medical and nursing in our hospital. Please proceed, Professor Dr. Sumariono.
Thank you, Dr. Trimartani. And assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, all college participants. And I'm from hospital management and also our distinguished speaker, Professor Yi Chun Len. In this presentation, I'd like to apologize to Professor Yi Chun Sen because many slides in this presentation I will deliver in Bahasa, but you can follow my presentation. Okay, next. Yeah. My topic is a strategic approach in management of COVID-19 RSM experience. Yeah, ini adalah pengalaman kita di RSCM selama menghadapi COVID-19 pandemik ini, dan di sini ada beberapa yang akan kami sampaikan. Yang pertama, profil untuk Rumah Sakit Cipto secara singkat, kemudian COVID-19 di Indonesia dan RSCM, dan selanjutnya adalah strategi yang sudah kita lakukan. Dan yang tidak kalah pentingnya nanti adalah mengenai tantangan di masa depan yang saat ini menjadi tantangan untuk semua kita, khususnya di Indonesia dan seluruh dunia. Slide. Ini yang sudah beberapa kali, yang sudah sering kali disampaikan oleh Direktur Jenderal WHO, bahwa semua kita, sebenarnya semua negara memiliki chance, memiliki kemungkinan, kemampuan untuk melakukan atau merubah perjalanan dari pandemi ini. Dan saya kira ini adalah satu himbauan atau satu permintaan kepada seluruh negara untuk melakukan berbagai upaya supaya bisa mengubah perjalanan dari pandemi COVID-19 ini. Slide. Ya, sebagaimana kita ketahui bahwa sebelumnya kita nggak begitu banyak tahu tentang informasi mengenai infeksi COVID ini. Baru setelah terjadinya outbreak di Wuhan, China, maka ini menjadi pandemi di seluruh dunia yang kemudian mengharuskan kita semua di seluruh dunia untuk bisa mengatasi, mengelola pandemi ini dengan sebaik-baiknya. Slide. Nah, ini adalah kondisi terakhir di Indonesia kemarin tanggal 7 Agustus 2020, di mana total kasus di Indonesia sudah mencapai 121.226 kasus. Dan slide. Ya. Nah, itu adalah kondisi secara umum dari permasalahan infeksi COVID ini di dunia, khususnya di Indonesia. Kami ingin menyampaikan sedikit mengenai RSCM. Jadi RSCM di 2024 ini mempunyai visi untuk menjadi National Referral Hospital di dalam pelayanan pendidikan dan penelitian yang terdepan dengan standar internasional. Slide. Dan ini adalah profil RSCM sebagai National Referral Hospital, ST National Teaching Hospital, dan juga sebagai Academic Health System Universitas Indonesia, di mana kepemilikannya Menteri Kesehatan. Kita ada 927 bed sebagai tertiary care hospital dengan 5.300 pegawai, dan itu pegawai rumah sakit, dan juga dengan 1.500 outsourcing. Dan sebagai rumah sakit pendidikan, maka di RSM ada 1.431 peserta didik, baik itu dokter, dokter spesialis, fellow, perawat, dan yang lain. Dan RSM sebagai rumah sakit pendidikan juga selalu melaksanakan penelitian-penelitian, baik penelitian klinis maupun penelitian non-klinis. Slide. Ini adalah data mengenai pasien rawat inap di RSCM mulai 2014 sampai 2019, di mana bornya mulai dari awalnya 2014 awal CKN itu 73%, kemudian menurun-menurun sampai 68%, dan 2019 itu sudah mulai meningkat kembali. Nah, tetapi pada tahun 2020 karena infeksi COVID, maka bor di rumah sakit itu menjadi turun sekali, yaitu sekitar 40%. Saya kira ini nantinya akan menjadi permasalahan terkait dengan bagaimana keberlangsungan rumah sakit, terkait terutama dengan masalah finansial. Slide. Nah, ini tadi sama seperti tadi sampaikan bahwa data terakhir kita adalah 121.000 kemarin, 220. Ini adalah kasus yang konfirmasi saja, yang terdeteksi dan terkonfirmasi. Dan slide. Di RSCM pertama kali kita mendapatkan kasus ini adalah di 20 Januari sebagai kasus rawat jalan yang kemudian kita rujuk. Oleh karena pada saat awal itu RSCM bukan sebagai rumah sakit yang rujukan untuk pelayanan COVID, sehingga pasien tersebut kita rujuk ke rumah sakit rujukan. Baik. Nah, ini adalah data-data tentang pelayanan COVID di RSCM. And I'd like to explain this slide. This is the data of our outpatient clinic since March to July. And we can see here that in the movement restriction phase, we can see the reducing the total number of outpatients in Cipta Mangunkusumo. But after relax of movement restriction, there is increasing number of outpatient clinic. And also this picture is same with inpatient data. So we have to have a program to fix this condition, and we have to solve this problem by many a program to solve this condition. Slide. And this is the age of patients, and mostly is less than 5 years and more than 65 4 years. Slide. And this is the graphic of daily inpatients COVID-19. And we can see here that in July, there is increasing number of inpatients at the last of week in July. And in early Augustus also, we can see increasing number of patients with COVID-19. Slide. Yeah. This is the data of all inpatients suspected COVID, and only about 23% of all patients was positive result with and swab PCR, and 77 was negative, and of the 33 confirmed cases, mostly adult, and 81% of those patients are with comorbidities. And we can see here, adult with comorbidities about 55%, without comorbidities only 15%. Slide. Yeah. Yeah. Ini adalah strategic approach untuk yang kami lakukan di RSCM terkait dengan bagaimana pengendalian COVID-19 ini. Slide. Ya, yang pertama adalah memperkuat untuk leadership di tingkat direksi, baik itu untuk di dalam sendiri, untuk seluruh staff di RSCM, kemudian untuk suprastruktur, kemudian juga untuk institusi-institusi yang di sekitarnya, di maksudnya adalah untuk lintas sektoral dan juga untuk customer, untuk pasien di rumah sakit. Jadi semuanya ditingkatkan peran kekuatan leadership di sini. Slide. Nah, berdasarkan pemikiran dan keputusan daripada board of director tadi, maka kami melakukan berbagai langkah, antara lain adalah satu, membentuk satu task force untuk COVID-19 langsung di bawah direktur utama, kemudian di sana board of director sebagai pimpinan gabungan di dalam operasional dari task force ini, dan task force ini sangat banyak membantu di dalam pelaksanaan atau di dalam menata laksana secara cepat kasus-kasus COVID-19. Terkait dengan hal ini, perlu kami sampaikan bahwa peran task force ini sangat menentukan untuk tata laksana secara cepat atau respons cepat terhadap kondisi di mana terjadinya perubahan yang sangat cepat pada pandemi ini, di mana kasus-kasus dengan COVID yang tadinya di bulan Januari-Februari itu hanya 2 kasus, tapi kemudian di Maret-April itu terjadi peningkatan yang begitu tajam yang harus membuat rumah sakit, manajemen rumah sakit ini memberikan respon cepat dan menata laksana dengan baik terhadap kondisi ini. Dan task force ini sangat penting dan sangat membantu untuk penata laksanaan atau tata kelola untuk pasien COVID di rumah sakit ini. Slide berikutnya. Nah, ini beberapa yang dilakukan, baik ini mengikuti beberapa guideline, antara lain adalah dari WHO dan juga dari penilaian kita di dalam rumah sakit, hal apa saja yang mesti dilakukan untuk bisa mengelola ini dengan sebaik-baiknya. Mulai dari membuat policy, kemudian pengorganisasian, membuat policy, kemudian komunikasi yang baik, ada guideline. Nah, sebenarnya mengenai guideline di nasional juga sudah ada guideline, tetapi guideline dan standar di nasional tersebut perlu dibuat lebih aplikatif, lebih sesuai di dalam pelaksanaannya dengan kondisi di Rumah Sakit Cipto. Kemudian masalah infrastruktur dan SDM ini juga permasalahan yang sangat complicated, yang kita infrastruktur harus disesuaikan dengan cepat, dan juga pengelolaan SDM juga perlu fleksibel dan mesti mengutamakan. Jadi dalam hal ini untuk tata kelola di terkait dengan hal ini, maka kita ada kebijakan bahwa pelayanan pasien COVID ini menjadi prioritas di masa pandemi ini. Kenapa demikian? Karena dia penyakit akut dan memberikan dampak yang sangat serius dan memiliki dampak kemungkinan mortalitas yang juga cukup tinggi. Sehingga ini menjadi prioritas utama. Dengan demikian, maka kita melakukan penyesuaian terhadap sistem layanan, di mana melakukan penyesuaian dengan kapasitas untuk pelayanan pasien-pasien non-COVID dan pasien yang kemudian sumber dayanya digunakan untuk pelayanan pasien COVID tersebut. Hal yang lain, logistik ini juga merupakan satu permasalahan yang penting, oleh karena pada masa-masa pandemi ini ketersediaan di lapangan mengenai logistik ini, baik itu terutama biasanya adalah mengenai APD, pelindung diri, baik itu masker, kemudian hazmat, kemudian gaun, itu yang utama. Yang lain-lain umumnya masih bisa disuplai dengan baik. Dan untuk hal ini, oleh karena pada masa pandemi ini banyak juga bantuan dan juga upaya-upaya bagaimana di manajemen dalam hal ini BOD melakukan upaya sehingga pemenuhan logistik ini bisa terjamin. Hal yang lain adalah tadi contingency plan terkait dengan kondisi-kondisi yang mungkin terjadi, kemudian koordinasi, monitoring, evaluasi, dan yang terakhir yang tidak kalah penting adalah masalah keuangan, dan ini menjadi pertimbangan penting di dalam pengelolaan ini dan harus diatur sedemikian rupa sehingga pelayanan COVID tetap terjaga dan pelayanan non-COVID disesuaikan dengan tetap memberikan kesejahteraan kepada semua pegawai di rumah sakit. Slide. Ya. Tadi mengenai apa yang sudah dilakukan tadi mengenai memberikan guidance dalam hal ini panduan, kita ada beberapa panduan. Yang pertama PPK. Nah, PPK atau panduan pelayanan klinis clinical practice guideline, kita sudah menyusun ini sejak bulan April ya, April, Mei, dan saat ini oleh karena jadi PPK ini sudah barang tentu mengikuti standar nasional, jadi National Practice Guideline, kemudian kita turunkan sebagai Hospital Practice Guideline, dan kita ketahui bahwa di guideline di Indonesia mengalami beberapa kali perubahan, dan yang terakhir ini di bulan Juli, dan oleh karena itu kita saat ini juga sedang proses untuk perubahan guideline yang terbaru, dan insya Allah di bulan Agustus ini akan bisa dikeluarkan edisi revisi dari PPK ini. Nah, selain itu juga membuat standar untuk penggunaan APD. Sebenarnya nomor satu adalah standar zonasi. Jadi kita melakukan zonasi. Zonasi di masing-masing zonasi ditetapkan APD yang diperlukan. Dan kita telah melakukan beberapa kali revisi juga, dan ini terkait dengan standar zonasi. Jadi APD akan mengikuti zona, dan zonasi juga mengikuti kondisi di lapangan terkait dengan kebutuhan pelayanan untuk pasien COVID ini. Mulai dari pertama hanya di IGD, kemudian selanjutnya ada beberapa di ruang perawatan diikutkan juga, dan selanjutnya yang ketiga di IGD Ultimate, dan yang terakhir kita hanya di Kiara Ultimate. Dan itu memerlukan penyesuaian dari panduan untuk alat pelindung diri ini. Dan berikutnya juga mengenai alur layanan di semua hal, baik di jenis layanan rawat jalan, rawat inap, kemudian emergensi, dan juga bagaimana alur-alur terhadap pemeriksaan penunjang, pemeriksaan swab, pemeriksaan alur-alur untuk operasi, pemasangan jenazah, dan juga nanti ada pedoman juga terkait dengan bagaimana kita mengelola pemeriksaan screening terhadap pegawai. Slide. Nah, yang berikutnya adalah memelihara awareness dari semua orang yang ada di rumah sakit ini, dan juga guidance untuk pegawai, untuk peserta didik, kemudian pegawai outsource di sini untuk guidance untuk health screening-nya. Nah, ini ada itu pedoman pemeriksaan kesehatan pegawai, kemudian peserta didik dan tenaga ahli di masa pandemi. Kemudian beberapa leaflet-leaflet yang sudah dibuat untuk memberikan informasi, memberikan awareness kepada semua pegawai di semua unit pelayanan di RSCM. Slide. Nah, terkait dengan pencegahan infeksi juga dari ini, bagaimana kita melakukan yang sebelah kiri, the left side itu adalah box untuk pemeriksaan pengambilan swab ya. Kemudian kita menggunakan presensi yang di gadget masing-masing, sehingga tidak tercampur dengan pasien lain, sehingga mengurangi risiko infeksi. Ya, tadi untuk panduan-panduan penggunaan alat pelindung diri. Slide. Kemudian protokol untuk memonitor gejala demam dan gejala-gejala COVID. Kemudian untuk membatasi, merestriksi mereka untuk mereka yang post exposure, dan juga bagaimana mengelola mereka untuk bisa kembali bertugas kembali. Dan ini semua sudah dibuat panduannya, baik untuk pegawai, untuk medical staff, dan juga untuk peserta didik. Dan terkait dengan hal ini jadi kita sebagai rumah sakit pendidikan, sebagai academic medical center, maka kita mesti bekerja sama dengan institusi pendidikan melalui badan komite koordinasi pendidikan atau KOMKORDIK. Slide. Nah, kita juga memberikan untuk dukungan kesehatan mental bagi semua sebenarnya ini, baik untuk pasien dan juga untuk pegawai kita, terutama untuk keluarga yang ingin mendapatkan informasi tentang kondisi keluarganya dan ingin berkomunikasi dengan keluarganya yang dirawat. Kita sediakan pojok sahabat untuk bisa berkomunikasi dengan mereka, karena di sini kita harus mengatur sedemikian rupa sehingga sesedikit mungkin orang yang dimasuk di dalam zona merah atau zona pelayanan COVID ini. Slide. Selain itu, ini sebagai tugas kita sebagai rumah sakit yang memberikan pengelolaan pasien COVID, maka harus melakukan laporan untuk data-data pasien kita ke HIS-nya, Hospital Information National Hospital Information System atau Sistem Informasi Rumah Sakit di Kementerian Kesehatan. Right? Nah, kita juga mengembangkan dan selalu memelihara komunikasi untuk healthcare profesional, kemudian pasien dan komunitas dengan berbagai cara kita laksanakan berbagai kegiatan webinar seperti ini. Nah, di situ ada live webinar dari berbagai topik yang terkait dengan COVID ini. Dan kita juga ada komik. Komik itu adalah untuk information center untuk COVID-19. Jadi COVID-19 Monitoring and Information Center. Sebenarnya di sini terdiri dari tim yang memberikan bisa memberikan informasi kepada pasien, kepada keluarga, kepada siapapun yang terkait dengan pemerintahan informasi terkait pelayanan pasien COVID di rumah sakit. Slide. Nah, RSM juga ada travel clinic di rumah sakit untuk mereka-mereka yang akan melaksanakan kegiatan traveling, apa saja yang mesti disiapkan, termasuk juga pelaksanaan pemberian vaksinasi dan juga edukasi tentang apa obat-obatan ataupun pencegahan yang harus dilakukan untuk masuk ke daerah-daerah tertentu. Slide. Nah, tadi apa yang kita lakukan. Kemudian berikutnya kami sampaikan mengenai zonasi ya. Tadi sebenarnya sudah kita sampaikan zonasi bagaimana kita melakukan pengelolaan untuk zonasi ini. Yang pertama, sebelumnya di RSM ini banyak sekali entry point. Dan dengan adanya COVID ini, maka kita harus mengatur sedemikian rupa flow pasien, alur pasien, entry orang, dan beberapa tempat yang tidak perlu, maka itu dilakukan penutupan. Sehingga hanya ada beberapa tempat, baik itu mulai dari IGD, kemudian dari rawat jalan, dan kemudian kencana. Hanya itu untuk entry point-nya. Semua tempat yang lain ditutup. Ini sehingga semuanya bisa terkendali masuknya pasien. Slide. Ya. Nah, ini adalah apa yang kita lakukan setelah tadi peningkatan kasus di IGD yang begitu signifikan, yang kemudian tidak bisa ditampung di sana, maka manajemen memutuskan untuk melakukan penambahan kapasitas dengan merubah outpatient kliniknya menjadi perluasan dari emergency untuk kasus-kasus COVID-19. Dan di sini ada 37 tempat tidur dengan ruang isolasi, high care, dan juga dilengkapi dengan ventilator. Nah, ini semua diupayakan dengan kerjasama dengan bantuan dari donatur, baik itu pribadi maupun kelompok. Slide. Nah, makin waktu di bulan Maret kasusnya sedemikian meningkat tajam sehingga kita putuskan untuk melakukan sentralisasi. Jadi selama ini di IGD, di IGD Ultimate, kemudian sama di beberapa ruang rawat, dan ini memberikan dampak risiko penularan terhadap orang-orang yang di sekitarnya atau pada jalur di mana pasien itu melewati jalur itu. Sehingga kemudian kita putuskan untuk mensentralisir satu tempat saja untuk pelayanan COVID, yaitu di Kiara. Dan alhamdulillah ini terlaksana pada tanggal 6 April 2020, semua pasien untuk pelayanan COVID disentralkan di sini, untuk semua jenis pelayanan. Nah, hanya saja di sini tidak semua langsung bisa selesai. Nah, khususnya untuk operasi, kita masih melaksanakan operasi di IGD karena masih memerlukan waktu untuk pembangunan untuk ruang operasi. Dan untuk operasi emergensi masih dilaksanakan di IGD. Slide. Yang lain adalah untuk family corner, ini juga tadi yang bisa membantu untuk komunikasi antara keluarga dengan pasien di ruangan. Slide. Tadi ya, komik sudah saya sampaikan. Right. Nah, telemedicine. Ini terkait dengan kunjungan pasien di rawat inap. Jadi untuk kasus-kasus yang konsultasi yang tidak harus menghadirkan dokter itu langsung ke tempat pelayanan pasien, maka bisa dilakukan dengan telekonsultasi. Yang kemudian pembahasan lanjutan akan dilaksanakan di namanya COVID Board. Jadi COVID kita selain ini juga ada namanya COVID Board yang selalu membahas secara rutin kasus-kasus yang ada di layanan COVID ini. Slide. Nah, sebagai rumah sakit pendidikan, kita juga melaksanakan penelitian. Banyak sekali penelitian yang saat ini berjalan, baik penelitian diagnostik maupun penelitian uji klinis. Paling tidak ada 4 uji klinis yang saat ini sedang berjalan, baik itu plasma convalescence, kemudian stem cell, kemudian pemberian beberapa obat antiviral. Slide. Ya, ini beberapa inovasi yang dilakukan di LSM terkait dengan upaya-upaya bagaimana bisa melakukan efisiensi di dalam penggunaan sumber daya dalam APD. Itu di sana ada UVGI chamber untuk mensterilisasi, kemudian reuse untuk jump sweep, kemudian family corner, hand sanitizer, dan lain-lain. Slide. Nah, ini adalah tantangan ke depan yang mesti kita selesaikan, kita hadapi, dan kita lakukan upaya supaya ini bisa terkelola dengan baik. Yang pertama adalah double burden. Jadi RSCM ini kita harus melayani pasien COVID dan non-COVID, kemudian masalah APD, protective equipment, terus kemudian screening dan diagnostik, kemudian permasalahan RSCM sebagai referral hospital dan sebagai academic medical center. Kemudian berikutnya adalah internally masalah behavior dari healthcare worker, jadi pegawai-pegawai kita, staff, baik itu tenaga dokter maupun tenaga kesehatan lainnya. Dan yang terakhir adalah kepastian untuk budget sustainability. Slide. Slide. Nah, untuk double burden, ini adalah bagaimana kita bisa memberikan pelayanan aman dan efektif untuk dua-duanya. Jadi aman untuk pasien COVID dan juga aman dan efektif untuk pasien non-COVID. Dan di sini isunya adalah ketersediaan SDM, kemudian safety environment, dan juga sistem yang aman dan efektif. Slide. Kemudian screening and diagnostic. Nah, mungkin di sini I'd like to inform about the how to manage a patient with asymptomatic patient. Asymptomatic patient that we have to check, to evaluate, to screen patient with asymptomatic. Because we know that if we want to evaluate to catch up the all of the asymptomatic patient, we have to make mass screen, and this mass screen, I think this is very big effort and with a very huge resources that we have to give. The second one is about the PCR test availability, and we know that in this condition, especially in Ciptamang Kusuma, we have a problem with PCR test availability because of or due to many problems. The first one about the reagents, and some reagent we get from the government and with the special access scheme, and after we use this reagent, and after that we have a difficulty in the sustainability of the reagent. Yeah, the test is test for test or screening, test for patient, and also screening for healthcare worker and for students. Next slide. Nah, mengenai PPE, ini permasalahan juga mengenai availability, kemudian masalah harga, dan yang ketiga ini masalah compliance dari semuanya, terutama bagi tenaga kesehatan yang menggunakan, karena dengan compliance yang tidak bagus itu akan meningkatkan risiko untuk terinfeksi dan penularan pada orang lain. Slide berikutnya mengenai referral sebagai sebagai rumah sakit rujukan, kita sebagai rumah sakit rujukan nasional, maka kita harus berikan pelayanan untuk pasien-pasien non-COVID. Dan kalau ini tidak dilayani juga akan memberikan dampak buruk untuk pasien tersebut, sehingga rumah sakit harus melakukan pelayanan untuk pasien yang non-COVID ini dengan optimal pula. Jadi saya kira ini problem satu. Dan kemudian berikutnya adalah terkait dengan peserta didik. Nah, peserta didik ini baik itu permasalahan mengenai bagaimana penempatan dan juga yang permasalahan berikutnya adalah bagaimana mereka bisa mendapatkan kompetensi sesuai yang direncanakan. Slide berikutnya. Nah, tadi healthcare worker behavior ini yaitu perilaku teman-teman kita semuanya. Ini misalnya berkumpul, waktu makan bersama, kemudian di tempat-tempat umum itu juga menjadi perhatian betul karena misalnya saja di rumah sakitnya bisa dikelola dengan baik, tetapi di luar itu kita tidak tahu dan itu mesti upaya terus-menerus untuk bisa menekankan kepada pegawai supaya selalu menetapkan protokol-protokol kesehatan. Dan yang terakhir, baik, adalah masalah sustainability dari budget. Saya kira ini juga untuk semua rumah sakit di Indonesia. Saya kira itu yang bisa saya sampaikan, Dr. Ria. Terima kasih. Thank you for all of participants.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sumaryono. Well, a good presentation about the strategic approach in Cipta Mangun Kusumo Hospital. Dr. Sumaryono has mentioned that at first we were not appointed as a COVID referral hospital. So by the mid-March, we have to act fast and then we initiate the task force for coordinating. We contain the strategy, containment strategy by zoning. And then allocate the allocation of human resource, early testing, continue information, data and research, and then of course financial allocation and supply chain. Nevertheless, we still have to learn more for further improvement and also the challenges in the future. So I think for the next 45 minutes, we will entertain several questions. Yes, the
I would like to thank you for the second presentation. I learned a lot from your experience. As you have already had experience dealing a lot of patients with suspect COVID-19. So thank you for your presentation. And I will try to answer some question from the audience.
Yes.
Regarding the course, what we have initiated and strengthened in the recent months is the majority based on SARS experience. We have very negative experience at that time. I would like to emphasize and sharing this experience. Although at that time, we do a wonderful job in the first month, but without collaborate, working together the nationwide, we, National Taiwan University alone, cannot combat the emerging infectious disease. So this is the reason why, for example, expert in your hospital, your experience, your knowledge, you need to share feedback to your government, to your colleague in your country. We need to work together. So after SARS, we stepwise review and modify our public health system and the healthcare system. The government visit and audit every hospital in Taiwan regarding infection prevention and control and the preparedness for emergent infectious disease and ask every hospital to provide education for patient, visitor, and the public regarding hand hygiene and wear mask when indicate. This is very important or infrastructure before any pandemic occurred. So this is the reason why the public have compliance to the recommendation or guidance from the government. It takes time to educate every individual, and very important to avoid stigmatize the people with emergent infectious disease. So every strategy or plan, we need to taking care the psychological feeling of patient, their family, and even our healthcare worker. This is the first part I try to answer. And the second part, because we initiate containment strategy early during pandemic, and we emphasize every individual in Taiwan, we need to wear mask or keep social distance, and emphasize the hand hygiene through different sector, including education system and media. So people have relatively good compliance to this policy. So this is a reason why we not yet need to so-called lockdown policy, as many countries are conduct in recent months. Lockdown policy is I think it's the last strategy to combat, to prevent the community spread of COVID-19. But very important, during lockdown phase, the government and the whole country need to some very aggressive control measure before reopen. But what I have learned from the media, if the lockdown policy not integrate with intervention measure, you can see the surge of the patient number again after relaxation of the lockdown policy. But every very stringent strategy, people will complain a lot. During the pandemic in 2009, pandemic flu, all the strategy is to delay and decrease the number of patients infected before we have effective vaccine for more cost-effective prevention. However, this strategy is not available yet for COVID-19. So we need to back to the very basic infection prevention or public health intervention policy. So we need to work together, educate, communicate, to work together. I think there's no alternative way. And this challenge the government and challenge the superintendent of each hospital. This is a very, very difficult part, especially from people involved in infection control, because the level is well above what we can control. This is the reason why I emphasize need to work together. So from your hustle, you can share experience, your knowledge to government and to other hospital and to the public. Try to influence others and work together. And do you see any government content improvement number? So, is this answer your question or any comment from your side?
Yeah, I think we do agree that the most important thing is aggressive control policy and effective prevention with the public health policy, and maybe lockdown is the last resort. I do agree with you.
May I ask a question? As you had experience for taking care a lot of patients with suspect COVID-19, how to surge capacity for a capacity of healthcare worker to translate into taking care of COVID-19 patient? Is it acceptable by people, for example, initially he is surgeon and you mobilize into the COVID-19 special unit? Is it the way you surge capacity for COVID-19 healthcare?
Yes, Dr.
Thank you, Prof. Yuxin. Prof. Yu Chun-Sin, I'd like to inform you about our experience in managing COVID-19 patients when the total number of patients began increasing in this short time. And in this condition, we as the management of hospital make decision that we have to make centralization of the services of patient with COVID-19. And with this approach, we can reduce the needed of the healthcare professional, especially for nurses. And because the nurses is very very important in the management of patient with COVID-19. And how to treat this condition? And we decided that we have to decrease the capacity of patient with non-COVID-19, and we only give treatment for patient with acute condition, and also in emergency cases, and that they, we cannot delay the treatment. So we only treat this patient. So the burden for non-COVID patients become lower, and we move the healthcare worker to the COVID-19 services. Maybe Dr. Trimartani, as the Human Resource Director, can add the information about it.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sumariana. Professor Yi, as we know that we really don't have, we cannot predict the healthcare workers that is needed for this long rally pandemic. We really don't know, and we have to save our energy. So there is, of course, limitation in internal medicine and pulmonary doctors specialized on that area. So what we do is we try to search our young orthopedics or surgeon staff to can give cater towards COVID, such as for doing swabs, for tracking and tracing, screening also, and of course in the midnight shift as well. And we elaborate with our training center. We did the reskilling, the new skilling also. We transformed our nurses, the second level nurses, and gave a short training on ICU patient. And of course, they were being supervised during their services in the ICU area. So that is how we try to fill in the gaps of the hospital care workers during this pandemic.
Thank you. Because our government now asks every hospital need to prepare the similar situation as you demonstrate in several slides. Thank you for sharing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Regarding the question from the audience, asked about whether there is a special or isolated room at emergency department. Yes, we double triage patient. So if patient with very high risk of COVID-19, for example, from the country or area with high incident rate, they will direct into negative isolation room located in emergency department. Through different traffic control, totally isolated from others. For the second level of the risk, low risk of COVID-19 patient, they will allocate to a certain area independent with ventilator, independent from other area of emergency room. After evaluation, two types of patients with risk of COVID-19, they will receive healthcare evaluation and collect sample for RT-PCR and decide the allocation later. So this is the reason why we stratify and the traffic control and allocate in a dedicated room for healthcare. Once we have a patient, for unknown reason, he stay with other patient without so-called COVID-19 risk. 1 hour later, from chest X-ray, we highly suspect he is COVID-19 or other virus pneumonitis. So immediate allocate to negative patient attention, because this is 1 hour gap, putting some exposure risk or nearby patient. So we immediate initiate investigation and conduct contact tracing and environment cleaning immediately to control any possibility or cross transmission or contamination to others. This is the policy in our hospital. That is the policy to triage patient with risk, but we also have a system working together to investigate and control any gap or any potential exposure when patient or healthcare worker exposed in the absence of appropriate protection. The appropriate protection is predefined by the government, very similar to WHO or CDC. And regarding to patient with immunodeficiency or other comorbidity, it is a really, really challenging we are facing, as you have mentioned. Therefore, we allow physicians to conduct RNA testing, PCR testing, if it indicated when you suspect in addition to national policy. National policy will define who can receive testing and the budget covered by government, including patients fulfill the criteria of notified cases and extended COVID-19 screening program. Both programs are for patients with symptoms compatible with COVID-19. However, our hospital has additional policy apply to those without symptoms, correlate or compatible with COVID-19. Very similar to what you have concern for patients with immunodeficiency or comorbidity. They might have a typical presentation or pre-symptomatic or asymptomatic. So this is the reason why I mentioned if any concern or any exposure, we agree physician to collect sample for PCR testing and the empirical initiate isolation precaution for this patient and modify thereafter based on clinical presentation or PCR testing. We need to modify the isolation precaution just because the limited or resource regarding PPE or isolation room. This is our policy. So we have government policy and we fine tune based on our physician perspective because we are a physician experience. We know the infectious disease had a typical presentation and how it's transmitted. So, and because we concern, we have many patients with immunodeficient status, they are very weak. So we cannot allow the COVID-19 spread in our hospital. In addition, according to the government policy, as well as hospital policy, if any patient is diagnosed after admission, we will initiate investigation immediately, including contact tracing and the environment cleaning, and we will initiate environment sampling for potential contamination if necessary. This is our experience.
Yeah, maybe Dr. Sumariano would like to add something.
Yeah, thank you, Professor. I'd like to add a question about the issue about the asymptomatic patients. As we know, and we face in last days that several patients with asymptomatic patients who treated in the ward, and then maybe this is asymptomatic or in the period incubation, and they become symptomatic in the ward, and then this is the condition. So my question is, what is the policy for patients who will or who plan to get inpatient care? Should we check with, for example, PCR for all of patients who plan to get inpatient care? Or are you still with a selection or with priority?
Okay, this is a very, very important question and a very, very difficult to make decision. Yes. Because we need to balance the resource
yes.
and the risk. So if the risk of committed spread is very high, mm-hmm. I will accept our physician request. They ask for testing everyone if the community risk is very high. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we need to think about the capacity of the lab. We need to prioritize those at high risk. Yeah, because if we mass screening, they will divergency the capacity and the turnaround time. Because we try our lab colleague, they do their best to provide the data within 24 hours. They do their best to provide the PCR testing results within 24 hours. But for many other hospitals, they get from collect the sample to get the data take about 3 days. They were, they will compromise your capacity, for example, isolation room and others. So this is very difficult part, and the need to your position or superintendent position, CEO position, you need to make decision and balance the two risk and resource. So this is the reason why we we have a superintendent office meeting for COVID-19 every day for several months, but we now step down to weekly meeting in order to make this decision and the need to fine tune very quickly. For example, we keep some connection with emergent department colleague to make policy to modify the risk every day. We announce and modify at 8 a.m. every day, modify, because the community situation and the international situation evolve very rapidly. So we need to modify and fine-tune our policy very quickly and the community very efficiently to across the department. So we're using the line and in addition to email or meeting, try every channel to explain our current policy. It is very difficult job, very, very difficult job. I think you already do a wonderful job, and we really learn a lot from your presentation. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Maybe question for Dr. Sumariono, Dr. Rabi. A question for Dr. Sumariono. Nggak ada yang tampil di sini. Yeah. This is question for Dr. Sumariono.
Yeah, how do you ensure the fitness and eligibility of
healthcare providers to be a team responsible for COVID-19 management?
Yeah. Regarding in RSM, how do you manage the triage in ER to make sure containment of transmission? Then how do RSM provide routine health? Okay. Thank you for the question. I think the first question, maybe Dr. Tri Martani will answer, but I will answer for the second question. In RSM, how do you manage triage in emergency room and to make sure there is containment of the transmission of the COVID-19. Yeah. How to manage the triage? Actually, we have a policy in this hospital that we have two emergency trias in private wing and also in public wing, in the public and private. And when the patients in private, there are symptoms of upper respiratory tract or symptoms of COVID-19, they will refer to the public emergency trias. And then in that area, we have make I mean zonation. Jadi, so we have a big zonation in the hospital and also a micro zonation in the in each unit. It mean I means the zonation in the emergency department. And in the emergency department, we have special room. This room is actually before we use as the room for emerging infection room. Emerging infection room, for example, tuberculosis and also SARS. But in this situation, we use this room for a patient with COVID-19. And this is the special room for COVID-19 in the emergency. And the other part that very important is to make a zonation in the emergency department with zonation and also the flow, zonation and flow of patients in the emergency room. The third one is about the using of the PPE. I think the third, there are three point in the emergency room to make that environment in the emergency room is safe. The first one is about zonation. The second one is the zonation, and then PPE in emergency department, and the third one is about the flow of patient in the emergency unit. Yeah. For the first question and the third question, maybe Dr. Timartani.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Question about the healthcare workers' health. So how we know that this is going to be a rally from March to end of December, hopefully. So we try to rotate them to our area of COVID for about 2 weeks or 1 month. After 2 weeks, they are going to have a test. So after the their duty, they are going to have a PCR or swab test, and then they have a leave for 2 weeks, and then they will rotate again to the COVID or non-COVID area. And then, of course, we also have a mental health services. Those who need consultation, there is an application, or we also open hours for consultation. And then, of course, education and awareness towards the new norm for how they attend meeting, how they take a lunch break, how they eat, and how to do their religious procedure, all in a new norm. And this is education, our awareness is being transferred every day to their application. So we hope by changing their norms or their culture to the new norms, they can be healthier towards this pandemic. Also, we do a routine checkup or testing, not only for those nurses or allied workers who are doing their duties in the COVID area, but also in the non-COVID area for the offices. We do a rapid test, and then for those who works in the ICU, in the emergency, we do the PCR every month. So this will help us to trace early detection and then isolate and then, of course, resting. I think those are mostly what we do the for the healthcare workers, and we hope that this will survive till the end of the year, hopefully, and then we'll finish this COVID, hopefully. Yes. Any question? No. Finish. So we have we still have 15 minutes, right, Rabi?
Yeah.
I would like to ask Professor Yi. I do hear a lot of double triage. I understand that you meant by double triage is having two rooms separately with a high risk probable COVID and a low risk, is it? Does that mean by the double triage? And what modality do you use for this triage?
Excuse me, would you please explain again your question?
You mentioned just now is about double triage. What modality do you use in triage? Is it you do lab tests, you do x-ray tests, or you do a screening test?
Okay, the triage is based on a very quick assessment regarding the exposure risk. It's very quick, and if high risk, the patient will direct into the negative pressure room located in emergent department. For some risk, but not high enough, they will allocate in separate area, where the ventilator system, the air condition is separate from the main building. The others go into our building, the ER building, then receive the regular triage regarding the severity of the disease. So the usual triage is the second triage, and the first is outside emergency room. We initiate the first triage outside emergent room based on the risk. It is very quick by question, as whether you come from and et cetera, et cetera. Then direct into different
places. Yeah,
health for the foreign detail evaluation or other healthcare. For risk of COVID-19, they will collect the sample for PCR and receive the chest X-ray to distinguish whether they have pneumonia or not. If without pneumonia and the immunocompetent and the mild disease, the government allow this kind of patient receive home isolation. After collecting the sample, they can go home, but the transportation between hospital and the home need to avoid public, they are prohibited to take public transportation. This is important part, prohibit to take public transportation. In addition, they need to wear mask. Make sure wear mask to avoid contact others. This is a so-called double triage. And our ER doctor, they try to communicate with patient with risk by with distance. This is so some barrier to avoid transparent share or others, or by telephone instead of very close and face to face, to avoid if possible the lower the risk of exposure. In addition to ER policy, we also have policy to secure the healthcare personnel safety. Yeah, because ER doctor, nurses, they are, of course, they fear, they have fear and concern, anxiety, because they are frontline. They are frontline, in the frontline, facing all this kind of risk, higher than other healthcare workers in the hospital. Yeah, so this is a reason why if any concern, we infection control personnel will involve investigation, contact tracing, and others to make sure our ER team are safe, are clean, need to integrate together to make sure. And we have, we very, very emphasize the occupation safety. Very, very emphasize this.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Yi. I think we have a very fruitful discussion, and then I'm sure that is beneficial for us both from Cipto Mangunkusumo Hospital and as well from National Taiwan University Hospital. So I think we have reached 11 o'clock, and then we have to close this session. And thank you very much. We have learned a lot. For the next week, we have other topics with our colleague from the National Taiwan University. It's about cardiovascular continuum of care in COVID-19 pandemic. And I hope everybody is looking forward to this meeting next week. Terima kasih. Thank you very much. And then I would like to close with Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Have a nice day.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Terima kasih.
Terima kasih. Terima kasih. Terima kasih.